What am I doing in southern Arabia? Well, I've come to try and find out more about one of the world's most elusive big cats, the Arabian leopard. Here, it's still a creature of myth and folklore and is an endangered species. When we think of Arabia, we tend to think of a land of sand and gravel deserts, places made famous by explorers such as Wilfred Thesiger. But Arabia is also a landscape of mountains. And these are desolate regions, but leopards love rocks. They can use them to hide away in. They can use them to stalk their prey. The ibex, the mountain gazelle, the rock hyrax are scattered scarcely throughout this region. And the Arabian leopard is superbly adapted to take advantage of this particular environment. But how do you film a creature which is so difficult to see? In Africa, leopards have got used to being approached by people in vehicles, but they're still one of the most difficult big cats to film. So here, we've had to use some high-tech gadgetry, small video cameras, which the leopards actually trigger themselves. And this, for the first time, is giving us a window into their secret world. But this is also a film about people, people trying to actually preserve and protect an endangered species, and of one particularly highly motivated individual, Hadi Al-Hikmani, who has dedicated his life to trying to protect the Arabian leopard. And I've come here all the way from Africa because I love leopards. I've spent most of my life watching them, to meet up with Hadi and have him show me around how they use the cameras, how this operation works, and to give me a better understanding about the Arabian leopard.
Arabia is fringed by extensive mountain ranges that once would have held healthy populations of leopard. But now, these creatures are found in only a few isolated areas. Here in the Sultanate of Oman, the leopard used to inhabit the Hajar mountain range in the north. But the last one was killed in 1976, shot by a shepherd protecting his goats. Other animals were also under threat, so a general ban on hunting was introduced. A small number of leopards were trapped to establish a captive breeding program. By the 1990s, most of the remaining wild leopards were thought to be marooned in the Dhofar Mountains of southern Oman. So little was known about them that the Arabian Leopard Survey was established, bringing together scientists and local people in an attempt to conserve them. The secret of the Arabian leopard's survival was due in large part to the rugged and inaccessible nature of the place where it lived. The Dhofar mountain range is crescent-shaped, providing protection against the sands of the empty quarter to the north, while also trapping the warm, moist air that rises off the Arabian Sea on its southern flanks. The western part of Dhofar receives much more rain than the east, supporting a greater variety of plants and smaller animals. A tailless whip scorpion and a skink go head to head. Further up the food chain, many of the larger carnivores have adapted to this unique environment by being more nocturnal. As the temperature drops, the remains of a dead camel attract several visitors. First on the scene is a genet, lured by the smell as much as anything else. About the size of a house cat, it transfers the odor of rotting meat to its fur, perhaps to enhance its own scent to other genets. Another night visitor is the rare Blandford's fox, a species that only occurs in the high mountains. Normally an insect eater, its smaller jaws cannot tear off large pieces of meat. Even chance meals like these are hotly contested. A striped hyena is more capable of dealing with this challenge. Able to crush bones with its powerful jaws, it decides that this is a meal best consumed in private. Perhaps the most spectacular part of Dhofar is to the east. The area is dominated by Jebel Samhan, a rugged mountain which acts as a barrier to rain-bearing clouds. But it hasn't always been so dry. These deep canyons, which are called wadis, were carved out by rivers thousands of years ago in wetter times. All that's left are their footprints, small rock pools, and the fish that inhabit them. Starved of soil, a frankincense tree erupts directly from the rock. Its dried sap is harvested as incense, for which the region is famous. The dracinia tree testifies to the lack of rainfall. Tough bark, narrow leaves, and slow growth are all adaptations to enable it to survive such an unforgiving environment. Small groups of female ibex and their young roam the wadis, browsing on trees and bushes during the cool part of the day. Male ibex usually travel alone and only join the females during the mating season. There are other predators in the region besides leopards. The wildcat and caracal lynx use the same trails as their larger relative. To live here, animals have had to adapt their behavior to survive the harsh conditions. Take the Arabian wolf, for example. Unlike its cousins in temperate climates that can live in packs of up to 20, here it lives singly or in pairs. And when times are really tough, they'll subsist on vegetable matter. There just isn't enough prey to support a large concentration of predators. Sitting at the top of the food chain is the Arabian leopard. But also sharing the leopard's mountain habitat are the Jabalis, or mountain people. Their life is adapted to this land of extremes. Their camels and goats can eat the spiky acacia thorn tree while also providing food and transport. Everything has a purpose. The Jabalis are as much a part of this landscape as the leopard. They have an intimate understanding of the area and know the location of every trail and every waterhole. Hadi al-Hikmani was born in these mountains, on the edge of the Jebel Semhan Nature Reserve. As a Jabali, he's been crucial to the success of the Arabian Leopard Survey.
سنبدأ الآن مسح نمر العربي في جبل سمحان حيث سنسعد الجبل لسير على الأقدام للبحث عن أي أثار أو أي دلائل علمية للنمر العربي حيث إذا مثلا وجدنا مثل هذه الأثار أي أثار حديثة سنقوم بنصب بعض الكاميرات الفخية.
With no roads in the mountains, it's impossible to move around in vehicles, so the survey has to travel on foot or by air. The team sets off while Hadi waits for the arrival of a helicopter. Water is scarce in the Jebel, so Hadi is asked for help in laying several supply dumps along the route. Once the drops have been made, Hadi will rejoin the team. Due to the high winds around the mountains, landing a helicopter can be tricky. The pilot drops a smoke flare to help judge the wind direction. Once food and water have been stashed, it's time to find the main party, somewhere on the edge of the reserve. To ascend the mountains, the team must have used one of the few trails that reach the top. These ancient pathways were worn by people who traded frankincense and other goods between the desert interior and the coast. Now the work can begin. The team head off along the escarpment on foot. As the trail works its way along the edge of the escarpment, parts of it become increasingly dangerous for the camels. It's easy for them to break a leg or to bolt over the edge of the cliff. These built-up trails are the only way along the escarpment for people and wildlife, thus making them good places to look for signs of leopard. Thank you.
الآن طلعنا بالضبط من وصلنا على القمة المنحدرة الجبلي جبل سمحان. تم هنا حصلنا مشاهدة يعني خدوش يعني خلال هذه الأيام حدثها النمور في هذه المنطقة. أكيد لا زال النمر يعيش في هذه المنطقة. آثار النمر هنا تقريبا هذه هنا المخالب وهو عمل مثلا كذلك.
The next day, Hadi and Khalid scout along the edges of the escarpment. There's more vegetation here, which attracts a variety of animals. Spotting an ibex is encouraging. It's important prey for leopards. The alarm call of these male ibex sounds more like a bird. After following the edge of the escarpment for several days, the survey turns north, heading deeper into the Jebel Semhan Reserve. The team have spent the night in a large cave, once used by herders who lived in the mountains. In the cool of the early morning, they prepare for another day on the Jebel. Camels aren't the easiest of animals to work with. The flat top of the Jebel makes for easy walking, but on either side are steep canyons, hundreds of meters deep. So far, Hadi has found little sign of the leopard on the mountain trails and thinks that they may stand a better chance if they search in the deep wadis. While there are gazelle on the plateau, there is little opportunity for the leopards to ambush them. They prefer the cover of wadis where the ibex and hyrax live. The signs are encouraging. An ibex horn could indicate a kill by a leopard. By counting the bumps, Hadi estimates that this ibex was at least 11 when it died, old for an ibex.
نعم هذا اكيد ما دام هذه الحيوانات موجوده اكيد النمر موجود فهذا يعني جيد جدا على اساس بقاء النمر العربي في هذه المنطقه.
But eventually they can go no further. Barred by a series of deep water pools and sheer cliffs. It's time to turn back. The survey team decide to try a large wadi to the east. The only way in is along an ibex trail, a narrow ledge several hundred meters above the canyon floor. Further along the ledge, they encounter the remains of a leopard kill.
Hey,
More proof of the presence of a leopard is found in the wadi.
ترتاد النمور عادة مثل هذه الكهوف. شوف هذه الخدوشنا. وهذه واحدة. هذه الخدوش.
In the soft dust under the cliff are fresh paw prints and scrape marks. Knowing that they're in the right area, the team finds suitable places to set up a series of remote cameras. Triggered when an infrared beam is broken, these small cameras provide a record of the leopards using this area. Unique coat patterns help to identify individuals. Once the team has gone, the natural residents of the wadi emerge again. Rock hyraks scramble into the trees to get at the leaf tips. One hyrax always remains on the lookout for hungry leopards. But danger doesn't just come in the form of a spotted coat. The hyrax has to be alert to danger from above. Rock hyraks are the main prey of the majestic Varroa's eagle. The intrusion of a predator causes alarm amongst the smaller birds. Being a ground bird, the red-legged partridge is one of the leopard's potential victims and doesn't hang around. Another bird, the Tristram's grackle, is also very alert and a thorn in the side of the leopard, often giving the game away when it hunts during the day. The bird's usual musical whistle turns into a loud alarm call when it sees the leopard, much to the cat's annoyance. The leopard continues on its way, searching for ibex. But once again, the leopard has been spotted. The loud cry of the Tristram's grackle alerts the ibex. The leopard decides to hunt elsewhere. Hunting at night carries its own perils. The Arabian leopard, like its African cousin, has been known to attack the nocturnal porcupines. Their sharp quills can easily wound a leopard. Several months have passed since Hardy and the team positioned the 8 remote cameras. Now it's time to check them. The results are encouraging, helping the team to identify several leopards that use this area. The most frequent traveller is a young male. Not all animals are as relaxed about the cameras. This red fox is slightly confused. As Hardy and the leopard survey team were at work in the mountains, I had to fly in by helicopter. I was able to gain a better understanding of the leopard's habitat as we flew over the rugged terrain, as Hardy pointed out some of their remote camera sites. As useful as the cameras are proving, they can't provide all the answers to the team's questions. To understand how much area the leopard needs to survive, it's critical that the team collect more information. And the way to do that is to fit a leopard with a tracking collar. Easier said than done. First, the team must catch the leopard. Using a large helicopter, a trap is placed near a trail that the leopard regularly uses. But because leopards roam over such a large area and are solitary, the team could be in for a long wait. Meanwhile, other nocturnal residents put in an appearance, such as a cautious wolf and the honey badger. Finally, several weeks after setting the trap, a young male leopard is caught. A vet is flown in. Sedating a leopard is a tricky business.
إذا جت ساعة ثلاث بعد نص ساعة وما حصل أي تخدير بنعيد الكرة بنفس القرعة مرة ثانية.
Once the leopard is safe to handle, the team have less than an hour to complete their work. Hardy attaches the collar that contains a global positioning device. This will record the exact location of the leopard every hour. A little larger than a dog collar, it's small and light enough not to hinder the leopard. Blood and skin samples are also taken to check its health and for DNA analysis. Up close, it's possible to see how the leopard survives here. Short fur helps keep it cool, and a lighter build reflects the scarcity of large prey in this hot, rocky environment. Racing against the clock, the leopard is measured and weighed before it begins to wake up. At 28 kilos, this leopard is half the size of its African cousin. Like any patient coming round from general anaesthetic, the leopard is a little groggy. But soon, the effects begin to wear off and it seeks the safety of the nearest cave to recover. Over the next few weeks, the team monitor the leopard to ensure that there are no ill effects. One night it shows up on a remote camera. The flashing signal on the collar is picked up by the infrared light, but is invisible to the leopard. The team are relieved that it's made a full recovery. At a predetermined time, the collar will automatically drop off, emitting a unique homing signal. This is used to find the discarded collar and retrieve the stored information. However, when the time comes, the radio signal can't be found. The collar seems to be lost. The extremely rugged terrain of Jebel Samhan is the problem. This mountain fortress, which provides so much protection for the leopard, also obstructs the recovery signal. The survey team expand their search with the use of a helicopter. They fly back and forth across the mountains and canyons, but the radio antenna fails to detect a signal. The collar could have fallen off while the leopard was in a cave or under a rocky overhang. To try and get a more direct signal, they decide to fly low through a wadi that is known to be frequented by the leopard. Still nothing. The team have to accept that the collar and its valuable information is lost. Perhaps the answer is to try the less rugged, greener area of Western Dhofar. On their flight back, they see thick clouds building up along the edge of the mountain, an indication that the weather is changing. The team race to move the cage before the onset of the summer monsoon. They place it in a new site, a cave set into a cliff face on a route known to be used by a resident leopard. Once again, all the team can do is wait. Warm air rising over the distant Himalayan mountains causes strong winds to rush along the coast of southern Oman. By mid-June, this has created a dramatic change in the weather. Winds drawn into the monsoon system stir up the Arabian Sea, whipping it into a fury and dragging up cold water from its depths. Clouds forming over the cold ocean drift inland. Moisture falls as it rises up the slopes, but little reaches beyond the mountains, while the rest of the country is enduring desiccating temperatures of up to 50 degrees centigrade, Dhofar is bathed in a blanket of cool mist. Known locally as the Karif, this is the driving force behind the extraordinary variety of wildlife. In years when there are heavy rains, it's possible to see how the great canyons were formed, the rock gouged out by the incredible power of water. Finally, a month after the trap was set, the team managed to catch a female leopard. She's quickly anaesthetized and collared. Hopefully this time, the team will be able to retrieve the collar, providing them with valuable information about how the leopard uses the terrain to survive. The Karif cloaks the mountains in mist and rain. The grey-headed kingfisher comes here to breed during the summer months when there's an abundance of insects in the long grass. The Rupel's weaver bird also chooses this time of year to breed. The male constructs several grass nests. With great dexterity, he weaves the strands together, creating circular baskets that hang from the tree branches. He spends all day prodding, poking, and adjusting until it's just right. In a frenzied wing-shivering display, he then invites a female to tour the premises and to choose the best. Perhaps it still requires a bit more work. Greater flamingos feed in the saltwater lagoons along the thin strip of land between ocean and hills. The flamingo's strange shuffle dance stirs up small crustaceans and algae. Life consists of an endless cycle of eating and preening. During the Kharif, there is plenty of new green growth for the Jabali's large herds of camels. This produces an abundance of rich camel milk, much loved by the herdsmen. Hadi and his family represent an ancient tradition linking his people to this extraordinary land and its wildlife. But what about the leopards' movements during the Kharif? The collar has been on the second leopard for a month. It should have collected lots of valuable data by now and dropped off. Hadi begins to look in an area where he last saw pug marks in the mud. But during this time of year, it's even more difficult. It all has to be done on foot, as it's not safe for a helicopter to fly in low-lying cloud. Searching along the wadi floors over several weeks proves fruitless. On a hunch, Hadi heads up into the hills, suspecting that the leopards will retreat into a cave during heavy rain. Finally, he begins to receive a weak signal coming from high up on a cliff face. At last, he's found the collar. Once the monsoon has passed and the land has dried out, it's easier for Hadi and Khalid to move around. With the data gained from the collar plotted on a map, they're able to see more clearly the pattern of the leopard's movements. They try to follow the route taken by the leopard. In general, the female chose the cover of the dense undergrowth of the hillsides, avoiding the open wadi floors. On a few occasions, the leopard passed near farms, but the data showed she only did this at night, almost certainly to avoid contact with humans. The female seemed to favor the sheer seaward-facing cliffs. It's impossible for Hadi and Khalid to follow any further. Only a creature as agile as a leopard can negotiate a way through such precipitous landscape. With a creature as elusive as the Arabian leopard, remote cameras and satellite collars are the only way to observe them and to reveal hidden aspects of their behavior. But it's not all good news. Hadi and Khalid have been watching with concern a young male with an injured leg over a period of weeks. Unable to hunt properly, he becomes thinner and thinner. Hadi is reluctant to anesthetize the leopard due to the stress that trapping and darting would cause. They decide to observe him for a little longer with the help of the cameras. The good news is the remote cameras don't seem to affect the normal behavior of the leopards. This opens a unique window into their secret lives. The cameras have shown that where there are no humans, the Arabian leopard is just as active during the day as at night, particularly around dawn and dusk. Leopards favor certain spots, usually in dust and gravel under rocky overhangs, where they leave messages for other leopards. Because these solitary creatures rarely come into contact with each other, these signposts provide an effective way for them to communicate. This male leopard is reacting to another male that has intruded into his territory. The forceful scrapes he gives as he leaves are a clear indication. Scent from glands on the leopard's cheeks are rubbed onto prominent rocks to leave the individual's distinctive smell, a useful signal when warning off an enemy or attracting a mate. It's not always the male that pursues the female in the mating game. This recorded incident shows a male in a state of agitation, being pursued by a female. Encouraging signs of successful breeding are seen when a female leopard is followed by her large cub, which decides to take its own route between the rocks. A little later, the injured leopard is spotted again, looking much healthier, with barely a trace of a limp. He gives a strong display of scraping, asserting his claim to this territory. Rather than being frightened by the cameras, the leopards use them as convenient rubbing posts. They're just the right height. Information gained about the Arabian leopard from this survey will help in its conservation, and not just in Dhofar. Recently, an ecotourism group guided by Hadi surveyed the province of Musandam in the extreme north of Oman, exploring the rugged peninsula that projects out into the Straits of Hormuz. Until recently, there was a small population of leopard here. Hadi and the visitors look for signs of the cats and their prey. After two seasons in the field, the group discover faint pug marks in the dust of a wadi floor, an indication that here there still may be a few leopards eking out an existence in the mountains of northern Oman. To raise awareness of the plight of the Arabian leopard in Musandam, Hadi and the team hold a meeting with the local residents. But understandably, the shepherds are vocal in their opposition to sharing their land with leopards. Hadi explains that if wild prey isn't hunted, leopards would not be forced to kill livestock. He also points out that tourists are attracted to the area to see, photograph, and study wild animals, and this in turn will help the local economy. Finally, a government official stresses that the preservation of the leopard is of national importance, a symbol of Oman's wild places. The success of this innovative technology would be impossible without the efforts of Hadi and the local community.
One of the things that I think is the real strength about what I'm seeing here is you, because you come from this area. This is your land. So your involvement with the leopard gives you the opportunity to share the chance to conserve this animal with your uncle, with your dad, with your family, and encourage them to see the leopard in a different way than perhaps they've done before.
Yeah, that's right. Because if you look, if I look at myself, I mean, 5 years ago or 10 years ago, I look from my point, the leopard is my enemy. I can't expect to protect it. But today, I do it from my heart. I want to do this thing.
So you've gone from being a camel herder to a conservationist.
Yeah, that's right.
When people hear what you do for a living, which is to work with leopards, setting up these camera traps, leading this extraordinary life, are they surprised to hear that there are leopards here at all in Oman? Do many people not even know that there are some left?
Yeah, the people from outside Jebel Samhan, yes, they look at it that's like there's something, oh, surprise, leopard here. But I mean, people, like local people here, they know that and they understand leopard here in Jebel Samhan. The local people to think it's good to work together because we need them. We need them, those people, we need them to understand us. And that's why, I mean, especially now, they help us a lot.
So they don't end up just thinking that people are trying to protect the wildlife against their interests. They see it that it's something that perhaps is that people are concerned about them as well as the wildlife.
I'm sure they look at the leopard from their view as their heritage.
So what do you think is the single most important thing that's going to be able to protect the leopard?
T- to protect Jabal Samhan. I think if we protect Jabal Samhan, the leopard will survive.
Jabal Samhan Nature Reserve is probably one of the last great strongholds of a creature which once roamed the full extent of the Arabian Mountains and numbered in its thousands. Today, it's one of the rarest leopards on Earth and faces an uncertain future. For it to survive, we have to find ways of bringing real economic incentives to the local people. After all, they're custodians of the leopard's home and of all the wild animals. And if we don't, then the leopard is destined to become simply a creature of myth and folklore, and it will disappear from this extraordinary land forever. What am I doing in Southern Arabia? Well, I've come to try and find out more about one of the world's most elusive big cats, the Arabian leopard. Here, it's still a creature of myth and folklore and is an endangered species. When we think of Arabia, we tend to think of a land of sand and gravel deserts, places made famous by explorers such as Wilfred Thesiger. But Arabia is also a landscape of mountains. And these are desolate regions, but leopards love rocks. They can use them to hide away in. They can use them to stalk their prey. The ibex, the mountain gazelle, the rock hyrax are scattered scarcely throughout this region. And the Arabian leopard is superbly adapted to take advantage of this particular environment. But how do you film a creature which is so difficult to see? In Africa, leopards have got used to being approached by people in vehicles, but they're still one of the most difficult big cats to film. So here, we've had to use some high-tech gadgetry, small video cameras, which the leopards actually trigger themselves. And this, for the first time, is giving us a window into their secret world. But this is also a film about people, people trying to actually preserve and protect an endangered species, and of one particularly highly motivated individual, Hadi Al-Hikmani, who has dedicated his life to trying to protect the Arabian leopard. And I've come here all the way from Africa because I love leopards. I've spent most of my life watching them, to meet up with Hadi and have him show me around how they use the cameras, how this operation works, and to give me a better understanding about the Arabian leopard.
Thank you.
Arabia is fringed by extensive mountain ranges that once would have held healthy populations of leopard. But now, these creatures are found in only a few isolated areas. Here in the Sultanate of Oman, the leopard used to inhabit the Hajar mountain range in the north. But the last one was killed in 1976, shot by a shepherd protecting his goats. Other animals were also under threat, so a general ban on hunting was introduced. A small number of leopards were trapped to establish a captive breeding program. By the 1990s, most of the remaining wild leopards were thought to be marooned in the Dhofar Mountains of southern Oman. So little was known about them that the Arabian Leopard Survey was established, bringing together scientists and local people in an attempt to conserve them. The secret of the Arabian leopard's survival was due in large part to the rugged and inaccessible nature of the place where it lived. The Dhofar mountain range is crescent-shaped, providing protection against the sands of the empty quarter to the north, while also trapping the warm, moist air that rises off the Arabian Sea on its southern flanks. The western part of Dhofar receives much more rain than the east, supporting a greater variety of plants and smaller animals. A tailless whip scorpion and a skink go head to head. Further up the food chain, many of the larger carnivores have adapted to this unique environment by being more nocturnal. As the temperature drops, the remains of a dead camel attract several visitors. First on the scene is a genet, lured by the smell as much as anything else. About the size of a house cat, it transfers the odor of rotting meat to its fur, perhaps to enhance its own scent to other genets. Another night visitor is the rare Blandford's fox, a species that only occurs in the high mountains. Normally an insect eater, its smaller jaws cannot tear off large pieces of meat. Even chance meals like these are hotly contested. A striped hyena is more capable of dealing with this challenge. Able to crush bones with its powerful jaws, it decides that this is a meal best consumed in private. Perhaps the most spectacular part of Dhofar is to the east. The area is dominated by Jebel Samhan, a rugged mountain which acts as a barrier to rain-bearing clouds. But it hasn't always been so dry. These deep canyons, which are called wadis, were carved out by rivers thousands of years ago in wetter times. All that's left are their footprints, small rock pools, and the fish that inhabit them. Starved of soil, a frankincense tree erupts directly from the rock. Its dried sap is harvested as incense, for which the region is famous. The dracinia tree testifies to the lack of rainfall. Tough bark, narrow leaves, and slow growth are all adaptations to enable it to survive such an unforgiving environment. Small groups of female ibex and their young roam the wadis, browsing on trees and bushes during the cool part of the day. Male ibex usually travel alone and only join the females during the mating season. There are other predators in the region besides leopards. The wildcat and caracal lynx use the same trails as their larger relative. To live here, animals have had to adapt their behavior to survive the harsh conditions. Take the Arabian wolf, for example. Unlike its cousins in temperate climates that can live in packs of up to 20, here it lives singly or in pairs. And when times are really tough, they'll subsist on vegetable matter. There just isn't enough prey to support a large concentration of predators. Sitting at the top of the food chain is the Arabian leopard. But also sharing the leopard's mountain habitat are the Jabalis, or mountain people. Their life is adapted to this land of extremes. Their camels and goats can eat the spiky acacia thorn tree while also providing food and transport. Everything has a purpose. The Jabalis are as much a part of this landscape as the leopard. They have an intimate understanding of the area and know the location of every trail and every waterhole. Hadi al-Hikmani was born in these mountains on the edge of the Jebel Semhan Nature Reserve. As a Jabali, he's been crucial to the success of the Arabian Leopard Survey.
سنبدا الآن مسح نمر العربي في جبل سمحان حيث سنسعد الجبل لسير على الأقدام للبحث عن أي أثار أو أي دلائل علمية للنمر العربي حيث إذا مثلا وجدنا مثل هذه الأثار أي أثار حديثة سنقوم بنصب بعض الكاميرات الفخية.
With no roads in the mountains, it's impossible to move around in vehicles, so the survey has to travel on foot or by air. The team sets off while Hadi waits for the arrival of a helicopter. Water is scarce in the Jebel, so Hadi is asked for help in laying several supply dumps along the route. Once the drops have been made, Hadi will rejoin the team. Due to the high winds around the mountains, landing a helicopter can be tricky. The pilot drops a smoke flare to help judge the wind direction. Once food and water have been stashed, it's time to find the main party, somewhere on the edge of the reserve. To ascend the mountains, the team must have used one of the few trails that reach the top. These ancient pathways were worn by people who traded frankincense and other goods between the desert interior and the coast. Now the work can begin. The team head off along the escarpment on foot. As the trail works its way along the edge of the escarpment, parts of it become increasingly dangerous for the camels. It's easy for them to break a leg or to bolt over the edge of the cliff. These built-up trails are the only way along the escarpment for people and wildlife, thus making them good places to look for signs of leopard.
طلعنا بالضبط من وصلنا على القمة المنحدرة الجبلي جبل سمحان تم هنا حصلنا مشاهدة يعني خدوش يعني خلال هذه الأيام حدثها النمور في هذه المنطقة أكيد لا زال النمور يعيش في هذه المنطقة هذا آثار النمور هنا تقريبا هذه هنا المخالب وهو عمل مثلا كذلك
The next day, Hadi and Khalid scout along the edges of the escarpment. There's more vegetation here, which attracts a variety of animals. Spotting an ibex is encouraging. It's important prey for leopards. The alarm call of these male ibex sounds more like a bird. After following the edge of the escarpment for several days, the survey turns north, heading deeper into the Jebel Semhan Reserve. The team have spent the night in a large cave, once used by herders who lived in the mountains. In the cool of the early morning, they prepare for another day on the Jebel. Camels aren't the easiest of animals to work with. The flat top of the Jebel makes for easy walking, but on either side are steep canyons, hundreds of meters deep. So far, Hadi has found little sign of the leopard on the mountain trails and thinks that they may stand a better chance if they search in the deep wadis. While there are gazelle on the plateau, there is little opportunity for the leopards to ambush them. They prefer the cover of wadis where the ibex and hyrax live. The signs are encouraging. An ibex horn could indicate a kill by a leopard. By counting the bumps, Hadi estimates that this ibex was at least 11 when it died, old for an ibex. But eventually, they can go no further. Barred by a series of deep water pools and sheer cliffs. It's time to turn back. The survey team decide to try a large wadi to the east. The only way in is along an ibex trail, a narrow ledge several hundred meters above the canyon floor. Further along the ledge, they encounter the remains of a leopard kill. More proof of the presence of a leopard is found in the wadi. In the soft dust under the cliff are fresh paw prints and scrape marks. Knowing that they're in the right area, the team finds suitable places to set up a series of remote cameras. Triggered when an infrared beam is broken, these small cameras provide a record of the leopards using this area. Unique coat patterns help to identify individuals. Once the team has gone, the natural residents of the wadi emerge again. Rock hyrax scramble into the trees to get at the leaf tips. One hyrax always remains on the lookout for hungry leopards. But danger doesn't just come in the form of a spotted coat. The hyrax has to be alert to danger from above. Rock hyrax are the main prey of the majestic Varroa's eagle. The intrusion of a predator causes alarm amongst the smaller birds. Being a ground bird, the red-legged partridge is one of the leopard's potential victims and doesn't hang around. Another bird, the Tristram's grackle, is also very alert and a thorn in the side of the leopard, often giving the game away when it hunts during the day.